Good morning. Welcome to St. Mary Ann's Episcopal Church on Sunday, August 16th. It's a blessing to have you here. We've got a faithful group of people here in our congregation this morning. We have Joel Alarcon and Luke Thress who will be joining us. You're applauding? Okay. for music. We've got a wonderful service planned for you today, a rainy morning. That's why we had to postpone or cancel our morning service, Mass on the Grass. And we'll begin our service momentarily with our opening hymn. Hello. Service will begin this morning in our program on page 3. Blessed be God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit.
And blessed be His kingdom, now and forever. Amen.
Almighty God, to you all hearts are open, all desires known. From you no secrets are hid. Cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name through Christ our Lord. We'll say together our Gloria. Glory to God in the highest, and peace to his people on earth.
Lord God, we praise you. Almighty God and Father, we worship you, we give you thanks, we praise you for your glory. Lord Jesus Christ, only Son of the Father, Lord God, Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world. Have mercy on us. You are seated at the right hand of the Father. Receive our prayer. For you alone are the Holy One. You alone are the Lord. You alone are the Most High, Jesus Christ, with the Holy Spirit, and the glory of God the Father. Amen.
The Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Let's pray together our contemporary collect found in your insert.
Almighty God, you have given your only Son to plead for us to sacrifice for sin, and also an example of godly life. Give us grace to receive thankfully the fruits of his redeeming work, and to follow daily in the blessed steps of his most holy life. Through Jesus Christ, your Son, our Lord, who lives and reigns with you, one God, now and forever. Amen.
Karen will now lead us in our readings.
Our first reading is from Genesis chapter 45, verses 1 through 15. Joseph could no longer control himself before all those who stood by him, and he cried out, "Send everyone away from me." So no one stayed with him when Joseph made himself known to his brothers. And he wept so loudly that the Egyptians heard it, and the household of Pharaoh heard it. Joseph said to his brothers, "I am Joseph. "Is my father still alive?" But his brothers could not answer him, so dismayed they were at his presence. Then Joseph said to his brothers, "Come closer to me." And they came closer. He said, "I am your brother Joseph, whom you sold into Egypt. And now do not be distressed or angry with yourselves because you sold me here, for God sent me before you to preserve life. For the famine has been in the land these 2 years, and there are 5 more years in which there will be neither plowing nor harvest. God sent me before you to preserve you, a remnant on earth, and to keep alive for you many survivors. So it was not you who sent me here, but God. He has made me a father to Pharaoh, and lord of all his house, and ruler over all the land of Egypt. Hurry and go up to my father and say to him, 'Thus says your son Joseph, God has made me lord of all Egypt. Come down to me, do not delay. You shall settle in the land of Goshen, and you shall be near me, you and your children and your children's children, as well as your flocks, your herds, and all that you have. I will provide for you there, since there are 5 more years of famine to come, so that you and your household and all that you have will not come to poverty. And now your eyes and the eyes of my brother Benjamin see that it is my own mouth that speaks to you. You must tell my father how greatly I am honored in Egypt and all that you have seen. Hurry and bring my father down here." Then he fell upon his brother Benjamin's neck and wept, while Benjamin wept upon his neck. And he kissed all his brothers and wept upon them. And after that, his brothers talked with him. Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
Today's psalm is Psalm 133, and we'll read it together. Oh, how good and pleasant it is when brethren live together in unity. It is like fine oil upon the head that runs down upon the beard, of Aaron, and runs down upon the collar of his robe. It is like the dew of Hermon that falls upon the hills of Zion. For there the Lord has ordained the blessing of life forevermore. Today's second reading is from Paul's letter to the Romans, chapter 1, verses 1 through 2a and 29 through 32. I ask, then, has God rejected his people? By no means. I myself am an Israelite, a descendant of Abraham, a member of the tribe of Benjamin. God has not rejected his people whom he foreknew, for the gifts and the calling of God are irrevocable. Just as you were once disobedient to God, but have now received mercy because of their disobedience, so they have now been disobedient in order that, by the mercy shown to you, they too may now receive mercy. For God has imprisoned all in disobedience so that he may be merciful to all. Here ends the reading.
Thanks be to God.
St. Matthew. Then Jesus called the crowd to him and said to them, "Listen and understand. It is not what goes into the mouth that defiles a person, but it is what comes out of the mouth that defiles." Then the disciples approached and said to him, Do you know what the Pharisees took offense when they heard what you said? He answered, every plant that my heavenly Father has not planted will be uprooted. Let them alone. They are blind guides of the blind. And if one blind person guides another, both will fall into a pit. Peter said to him, explain this parable to us. Then he said, are you still without understanding? Do you not see that whatever goes into the mouth enters the stomach and goes out into the sewer? But what comes out of the mouth proceeds from the heart. And this is what defiles. For out of the heart come evil intentions, murder, adultery, fornication, theft, false witness, slander. These are what defile a person, but to eat with unwashed hands does not defile. Jesus left that place and went to the district of Tyre and Sidon. Just then a Canaanite woman from that region came out and started shouting, have mercy on me, Lord, son of David. My daughter is tormented by a demon. But he did not answer her at all. And his disciples came and urged him, saying, send her away, for she keeps shouting after us. He answered, I was sent only to the lost sheep of the house of Israel. But she came and knelt before him, saying, Lord, help me. He answered, it is not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. She said, yes, Lord. Yet even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from their master's table. And Jesus answered her, woman, great is your faith. Let it be done for you as you wish. And her daughter was healed instantly. The Gospel of the Lord.
Praise to you, Lord Christ.
Son and Holy Spirit. Amen. I miss being in church. I miss being cool. Without the sun glaring in my face. We have a very messy gospel passage today. We've got some beautiful readings in our bulletin, so I urge you here at home to take them. One is the refrain from the psalm. How good and pleasant it is to live in unity. Don't we need so much of that today? So this is a difficult passage. St. Matthew connects this discussion of first century dietary laws and what could be touched or what could be eaten with Jesus' encounter with this Canaanite woman. He sort of fits them together and they don't really fit too well. It's a very difficult passage for preaching as questions are raised that are difficult to answer in just a single homily. This passage has a demon in it, Jesus ignoring the cries of a desperate mother, the annoyed disciples, this sort of confusing mission of Jesus. We're not sure what his mission is. It's a restrictive mission. And this apparent insult of Jesus calling this woman a dog. Preaching this kind of passage reminds us that life is messy, and I think we'll struggle together through this gospel passage this morning. Besides this passage in St. Matthew's Gospel here, you're going to find this a very similar conversation in Mark's Gospel in chapter 7. It's one of the most interesting conversations that's ever recorded in the Gospels. It's seemingly awkward. It can be offensive and perhaps even perplexing to us. This story is about God's grace being offered for the Gentiles. And in an arresting way, Jesus affirms his mission to both the Jews and the Gentiles. It might look like that Jesus is indifferent or reluctant, but actually the story teaches us the opposite. And I want to focus on two things this morning in particular, what this passage teaches us about Jesus' mission and what the woman's response to Jesus teaches us about Jesus' person. It's important to know that Jesus here is in Gentile, meaning non-Jewish territory. He's outside not only of Judea and of Galilee, he's in a place where prudent Israelites don't want to walk alone. I mean, think about it. Jerusalem, in terms of reference, geography, Jerusalem is 75 miles to the Sea of Galilee. So Jesus is in that area. Now, it's like us traveling from here to Allentown, Pennsylvania, right? Or Harrisburg. And Tyre and Sidon, this district that he's in there, is like, it's about another 50 miles away from there. So that's like us going from here north to Route 80, Strasburg, Pennsylvania, if you've ever been up that way. That's a pretty big distance that he went on foot, traveling all around that area. Now he's in an unfriendly place. There's racial stereotypes, there's bigotry. Those had to happen, most of the encounters with Israelites and Canaanites. But often, as happened when Jesus travels, he was found anyway. This Canaanite woman, this literally a Greek-speaking woman who was born in Syria, Phoenicia, right, which is right on the water there, seeks him out. She falls at his feet. She begs him. She shouts him to liberate her daughter with a demon. The woman is desperate. And Jesus appears dismissive. At first glance, Jesus looks indifferent, rude, if not cruel. He uses a derogatory term for Gentiles, dogs, he calls them. Jesus suggests that her request is for aid is out of place, since if he were to answer her, he would be giving her what belongs only to the lost sheep of Israel. Jesus essentially says, it would not be right for me to do what you're asking for. And we're left jarred and shocked here. Like, what is going on here? We learn that the woman pled with Jesus to have mercy on her because her daughter was demon-possessed, and Jesus doesn't answer a word. In fact, as she begs him for help, her disciples beg Jesus to send her away. She's shouting, the disciples are shouting, send her away. In other words, Jesus is saying to her, my mission is to Israel. I'm here for their children, not for the dogs. I'm here for the Jew, not for the Gentiles. Matthew says she's undeterred by this. She kneels before him and begs, Lord, help me. Desperate. That desperate plea, Jesus said to her, it's not fair to take the children's food and throw it to the dogs. What is going on here? Where is my Jesus? What have you done with him? If we read this passage out of context and we don't even read the companion passage from Mark, it's hard to understand what's going on. See, if we look and listen carefully, the Holy Spirit shows us in this passage God's grace is to the Gentiles. But he does it in the most striking way. He introduces us to this pagan woman who seems to understand things that even Jesus' disciples don't understand. He presses on the issues about the merit of her faith. He gives us a striking example of what happens in prayer. And he reveals to us Jesus as the Savior of the world. So if we put our noses back in the passage and ask the question, do these words really reveal that Jesus, who was unconcerned for the Gentiles and unmoved by this woman? Paying careful attention to both Gospels, St. Mark and St. Matthew, the answer is emphatically no. And I want to point out two lines of evidence for that. First, the trip that he takes up to Tyre and Sidon. He's sort of in enemy territory here. It's clearly and purposely planned by Jesus in order to explain his mission. The inclusion of the words about the children's food are an important and deliberate part of the explanation. The second thing I want us to see is what we learn from the way the woman approaches Jesus, how she identifies him in her response to him. So the passage is showing us a deliberate, purposeful mission to the Gentiles by Jesus. The gospel writers give us everything we need to see everything about this mission to the Gentiles. See, Jesus has been all over this region. All of the healing we've heard about, the feeding of the 5,000, the feeding of the 4,000, has all happened in Gentile territory. So if he wasn't called to the Gentiles, why would he go there? He's feeding them, he's healing them, he's teaching. It's very clear that this is meant to teach the disciples, and now us, something important about Jesus' mission and ours as followers of Christ. The whole future of the Christian movement is strengthened by encounters like this in the gospel. Jesus goes to the worst possible place to preach and teach. Tyre is a place where Queen Jezebel, right? You've heard the name Jezebel. Everybody knows Jezebel's probably not a good thing. She was the worst woman in Scripture. You want to read about her today? It's a cloudy day, rainy day. You're going to stay inside. Read Kings, 1st and 2nd Kings. You'll learn all about Jezebel. Ooh, that'll give you chills. She introduced pagan worship, Baal, into the northern kingdom. The first century Jewish historian, again, Jewish, not a Christian, a man named Josephus, he said Tyre was notoriously our bitterest enemy. So Jesus, he's going deliberately there to the Gentile region, and this Gentile woman, in order to teach the disciples, you and me, about his mission. So the first line of evidence I want you to see in this passage is this is really a mission to the Gentiles. So the second line of argumentation here is the woman's response to Jesus teaches us who he is and what his mission is. The woman's response to Jesus also teaches us about prayer, teaches us about faith, it teaches us about Jesus' mercy. It teaches us about the Gentile mission. In John's Gospel, chapter 4, Jesus engages a Samaritan woman, leading her to a conversation and the salvation of many in her city. In Mark, this companion passage I mentioned, so this, he mentions the same woman, but he calls her a Greek-speaking, Gentile, Syrian, Phoenician, Canaanite woman. How is that for what's called intersectionality? That's like a mixing of all of the different things that you would put in there. She's somebody because of her race, her gender, her religion, her class, that could have been marginalized. There's no racism here with Jesus. If ever someone was a Gentile in the flesh, separated from Christ, alienated from the commonwealth of Israel, a stranger to the covenants of promise, having no hope and without God in this world, it's this woman today. And Jesus is standing in front of her. The Messiah has come to her. So notice how she approaches, she addresses Jesus. She kneels before him. She calls him Lord 3 times. She specifically gives him the messianic title of Lord, Son of David. In other words, her identification of Jesus is far more insightful than the Pharisees and the disciples. It's more insightful than the crowds. In fact, it won't be until later on that Peter the apostle will give this identification of Jesus. He's already heard it with his own ears from this Gentile woman in this region of Tyre and Sidon. She identifies Jesus as the Messiah. Her hope and her confidence is in his person. She's staking her whole trust in him. Notice her appeal here, her request. She's determined. She's persistent. She's relentless in her pleas. She falls down at his feet and begs for her little daughter. In Greek, it's my little girl. With a raised voice, she said, have mercy on me. My little girl is tormented by a demon. She says, Lord, help me. She puts her whole hope in his answer to that cry. And what a reminder and a lesson that is for us about prayer. I love what Anglican Bishop J.C. Ryle said in the late 1800s about the little girl in this passage, this little demon-possessed girl. Bishop Ryle said, hopeless and desperate as her case appeared, she had a praying mother. And where there's a praying mother, there's always hope. Sometimes all we can do for our children is to pray for them. So this woman stays fixed, locked, focused on her request and her hope, even when she meets apparent indifference, apparent rejection, apparent dismissal. Jesus ignores her. The disciples say, send her away. He then speaks to her as if to deny her request. He even uses a term of disrespect, a derogatory term for the Gentiles. And by the way, aren't you glad that Peter wasn't live tweeting this? That'd be on the news. Jesus would have gone viral in the worst of ways. There would have been almost an infinite thread of rage tweets about his heartless and racism and misogyny. Nevertheless, she's persistent. She even agrees with him. Yes, Lord. Even the dogs eat the crumbs that fall from the master's table. Jesus had already given her two discouraging replies. It's almost as if his replies were echoing what the disciples were thinking. But we need to factor a couple of things in here when we consider Jesus' words to her. She knows who Jesus is. She says, "You're the Lord. You're the Son of David. And these men you brought with you, they may not totally understand that, but I do. I know who you are." So she's saying, "Lord, that's fine. Satisfy them first. I'll take the crumbs. I'll take the leftovers." It was as if Jesus said the children have to be satisfied first. And she responded by saying, "So there's a chance." He verbally tips her off here so that the door is not as closed as it may seem. The woman sees what? That there's hope. Believing there's mercy here even for her and her daughter. The woman knows that she has no grounds to expect help. She's a Gentile. She's there in the flesh. She's of the uncircumcision. She's not of the commonwealth of Israel. She's a stranger to the covenants of promise. But she's talking to Christ, the Messiah. Therefore, she's not without hope. It's almost like she's saying, "Yes, Lord, you've come only for the lost sheep of Israel, but I notice you're here. You're hanging out with us here in Tyre, in Sidon, the enemy territory. We look different. We talk different. We dress different. And yes, Lord, the food is only for the children, but you know what? You're here talking to me." She apprehends his mercy. She sees through the words he's spoken. She knows who this is. She says to him, "My sins that are many, but your mercy is more." And Jesus says, "I won't do this. I shouldn't do this." And then he does it. Her daughter is healed immediately. By the way, in the Gospels, this only happens with the Gentiles. Everywhere else, Jesus goes to the one who's in trouble. But with Gentiles, he can heal them with a word without even going there. He doesn't even speak a word. And he says to her something that he never, ever said to an Israelite. "Your faith is great." Jesus only commends the faith of Gentiles in the gospel. Jesus has been showing his mission to the Gentiles in words and deeds throughout the Gospels. In John, in chapter 10, he says, "And I have other sheep that are not of this fold. I must bring them in also, and they will listen to my voice, so there will be one flock, one shepherd." In the kingdom of God, people from Egypt and Babylon, Philistia and Tyre and Cush will be numbered among the Messiah's people. All colors, all races, all. Loved ones, this is one of the things that reminds us that missions is rooted in the vision of the people of God. We can never fail to bring the word of Christ to all, no matter what race, religion, even if they're from Tyre, Sidon, or Allentown, Pennsylvania. It's not just an Old or New Testament thing, it's a Bible thing. To Abraham, God said, "In you all the families of the earth will be blessed." God is making his name known among the nations. That's why we must be concerned to share the gospel with men and women and boys and girls from every tribe and tongue and people and nation. It's not really an option for us. It's not a New Testament thing. It's not an Old Testament thing. It's a Bible thing. What a God. What a Savior. What a beautiful gospel. To God be the glory, now and forever.
Amen.
Well, we'll continue on in our service with the Nicene Creed. You'll find that in the bulletin or in your home in the book of common prayer. I'll say that again. We believe in one God, the Father, the Almighty, Maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally God from the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten on the day of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made, for us and for our salvation. lead us in our prayers.
Let us pray. Father, we pray for your holy Catholic Church.
That we all may be one.
Grant that every member of the Church may truly and humbly serve you.
That your name may be glorified by all people.
We pray for all bishops, priests, and deacons.
That they may be faithful ministers of your word and sacraments.
We pray for all who govern and hold authority in the nations of the world, for our President Donald Trump, and for our Governor Larry Hogan, and for those serving in our military.
That there may be justice and peace on the earth.
Give grace to do your will in all that we undertake.
That our words may find favor in your sight.
Have compassion on those who suffer from any grief or trouble.
And that they may be delivered from their distress.
Give to the departed eternal rest.
Let the light perpetual shine upon them.
We praise you for your saints who've entered into joy.
May we also come to share in your heavenly kingdom.
Today we pray for the healing and recovery of Ron and Doris Stover, Carl Walbeck. We pray for the Holy Spirit to guide and support the England family and Robin Farmer. And we pray for those who have recently died and their families, Stephen Stanton and Jeff Beals. Let us pray for our own needs and those of others.
We continue to pray that today and always for those affected and afflicted by the coronavirus. Pray for their families. We pray for those in hospitals and in care facilities. We pray for those who suffered economic loss during this time. We hope that they may find work and may find sources of income, food, sustain themselves and their families. Let us confess our sins against God and our neighbor. Most merciful God,
we confess that we have sinned against you in thought, word, and deed, by what we have done and by what we have left undone. We have not loved you with our whole heart. We have not loved our neighbors as ourselves. We are truly sorry and we humbly repent. For the sake of your Son, Jesus Christ, have mercy on us and forgive us, that we may delight in your will and walk in your ways to the glory of your name. Amen.
May Almighty God have mercy on you, forgive you all your sins through our Lord Jesus Christ, strengthen you in all goodness, and by the power of the Holy Spirit keep you in eternal life. The peace of the Lord be always with you. Let's offer one another a sign of God's peace. God's peace. You may be seated. A couple of announcements that are here. Next Sunday, the 23rd and also the 30th, Karen and I will be away. And we have Bishop Bud Shand, who will be here next week for one service at 9 a.m. One service at 9 a.m. And you'll see lots about that over the next week as we continue to remind people that there'll be one service at 9 a.m. for the next 2 weeks. So Bishop Bud will be here on the 23rd. For those of you who may not know Bishop Bud, it's a wonderful opportunity for you to come and meet him socially distant, which is probably very hard for Bud. Knowing Bud, as anything socially distant would be very, very hard for him. But Bud was rector here many years ago, and then became was rector in another parish and became bishop of the Diocese of Easton. So he's a wonderful man, lots of history, and hopefully he'll tell a Bud story or two, because he's got some good stories, especially about this area, this church. On the 30th, Reverend Pat Droskunz will be here. Reverend Pat is a retired Episcopal priest. She's been with us before and worshiped with us. She was rector at St. Mark's in Perryville. She now lives in the Easton area with her husband, Tom. So I invited Reverend Pat to come and to officiate at one service, 9 a.m. on the 30th. You're getting it. That's good. Okay, a couple of other things before we move on. We do have our virtual choir today, right? Howell knows that we're going to have that. We'll have that music, and Alex has been very very diligent. I think this might be the 10th. Is this the 10th, Carol? Yeah, you're in the virtual. Carol's in the virtual choir, but she's here not virtually. She's here in she's really here. So a couple of things going on. One is, if you've got the e-news, I just want to refresh and remind you that the Thompson Memorial Crocus lawn, we're raising some funds for that, where people can buy bulbs that will be planted in the fall. And you can see that in the e-news, or you can call the office and we'll get back to you. Also, I'm starting in September, September 8th, driveway communion. You're saying, what is driveway communion? Well, since we aren't able to have everyone either in the church physically here, or people who, because of concerns, can't come to the grounds, the outside, for services, I'll go to them, or they can come here to me to offer communion, a time of prayer, or just to talk. I miss so many people and don't get to see everyone. So driveway communion would be, I would come to your place and either sit in the driveway and bring my chair, and we can be socially distant, and I'll have communion that's in a little baggie that's been consecrated and safely done with all of the proper CDC protocols that I can offer to you or spouse or loved ones who might be with you. I can sit on your deck or on your porch, whatever you'd like, and we can be again the socially distant and do that. You can come here. We can meet on the gravel driveway, and you can just stay in your car if you feel uncomfortable about getting outside. I would like you to put your window down though, so I can actually talk to you, or I could slip the little communion host. Well, we don't have vent windows anymore, do we? I miss vent windows. I'll slip the communion host right in there, so we can do that. Or we can meet in the parish house. I've met people in the parish house. The air conditioning is on in there, and it's completely empty, so you can be at one end and I can be at the other end, and everyone can be safe. So driveway communion. I already have a couple of people that have scheduled that time, so that'll be beginning on September 8th. And it'll be Tuesdays, Wednesdays, and Thursdays, and we'll schedule that from 11 to 4 p.m. So I hope that that we can do that. EFM is starting up, and EFM is a wonderful course. It's a wonderful time of fellowship and bonding and learning. And some of the stuff I mentioned today, you'll learn all of that in EFM and go into depth for as you wish. So contact Carol Weisel or Bob Doyle if you'd like to be part of EFM, or to learn about EFM, and I'm sure they'll be happy to share that with you. There is a dialogue series on racism that has begun with a group that is I think training to be facilitators, so we can spread this group out. It's called Sacred Ground, and it's an Episcopal Church dialogue program from the National Church. It's a series of Becoming a Beloved Community initiative in the Episcopal Church. It's a long-term commitment by the church, by the diocese, and by us here at St. Mary Ann's to racial healing and reconciliation and justice in our personal lives, in our ministries, and in our society. So I hope you've read the e-news. If not, we can send out some information about it and look for more of these dialogue groups to begin in the fall. So let's see. For those of you who are having birthdays or anniversaries, dear Lord, we ask your blessing upon all who are having birthdays or anniversaries during this time. Be with them, watch over them, continue to build their faith and strength and courage all their days. The blessing of God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be upon them and with them always. Amen. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice.
Therefore, we proclaim the mystery of faith.
Christ is risen. Christ will come again.
Celebrate the memorial of our redemption, O Father, in this sacrifice of praise and thanksgiving. Recalling his death, resurrection, and ascension, we offer you these gifts. Sanctify them by your Holy Spirit to be for your people the body and blood of your Son, the holy food and drink of new and unending life in him. Sanctify us also, that we may faithfully receive this holy sacrament and serve you in unity, constancy, and peace, and that the last day bring us with all your saints into the joy of your eternal kingdom. All this we ask for your Son, Jesus Christ, by him, with him, in him, in the unity of the Holy Spirit, all honor and glory is yours, Almighty Father, now and forever.
Amen.
And now, as our Savior Christ has taught us, we are bold to say, Our Father, who art in heaven,
hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Hallelujah, Christ, our Passover is sacrificed for us.
Therefore, let us keep the feast.
Hallelujah.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Have mercy on us.
Lamb of God, you take away the sin of the world.
Grant us our peace.
These are the gifts of God for the people of God. Take them in remembrance that Christ died for you. Feed on him in your hearts by faith with thanksgiving. God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit be upon you and remain with you always. Amen. Go in peace to love and serve the Lord. Alleluia, alleluia.